Good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Newton, Iowa. I have a couple announcements, or maybe just one. My brain might move and I'll think of something else. But I did want to let you know from the membership committee that we will again be participating in the July 4th parade. The July 4th parade is actually on July 3rd. But we'll be participating. We're going to have the membership committee proposed and session approved that we have a modest parade entry and a watch party from the front lawn. So church life will help coordinate this endeavor, and we're going to need a pickup truck with a driver and volunteers to help decorate the truck, and then also volunteers to help host the lawn watch party, which probably know that our lawn is a very good place to watch the parade, and hence it fills up quick. So if we want to have a lawn, you're going to have to get it there a little early. But if you're interested in either helping with any of those those parade events, please let Marilyn McAllister or Gary Parsons know, and just let us know if you're interested. I thought I had other announcements, but right now I can't think of them. So let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Please rise in body or in spirit to join in the call for worship. When forces in the world threaten us,
when our bodies or spirits turn against us,
there is one who seeks us,
one who meets us,
one who heals us, whose love voices over us and sets us free for joy.
This one is the Lord.
Come, let us worship God. The geography of sin is a waterless waste, but God gives streams of living water, streams of justice and mercy splicing into the wilderness from the mountain of God. Let us drink deeply of Christ. Let us confess our sins. Please join me in the confession of the people. Holy One,
God Most High, grant us faith to confess our sins and seek your mercy. There are barren places in our lives where we have wandered far from you. We have listened to voices who distracted us from your call. We have submitted to powers competing for our loyalty to you. God, our Savior, forgive us. Quench our thirst for you from the rock of our salvation, and let your love well up in us and into eternal life. Amen.
Exactly, it's still spring, but it definitely seems like summer, right? And right before summer comes spring, and then what's the cold one? Winter, yes. So in weather, we have different seasons, and in the church, we have different seasons also. And in the church, one of the seasons is Christmas, you know that one, right? Another season is Easter. And we have the seasons that lead up to Christmas and Easter, which are Advent and Lent. And then we have, which actually is the longest season of all, we have a season called Ordinary Time, which sounds kind of boring, but it's not, oh, what is my ordinary time? I'm looking for it in my book. Here we go, Ordinary Time. And then each season has a color. And ordinary time, the color is green. So that's why you see green up there, and you see green on my stole. So I'm just going to read you a little bit about ordinary time from this announcing book called Come Worship With Me. In between the special seasons at church, there is ordinary time. When we worship God during ordinary time, we celebrate God's everyday blessings. A blessing is something given by God. Food is a blessing. Hope is a blessing. So are snow days and good friends and whistling. Blessings are everywhere. We can thank God for them by serving God. Jesus served God. He preached good news to poor people. He healed sick people. He made friends with people that nobody else liked. And he showed God's love to all. Jesus was a great leader. He taught us to lead by serving. There are many ways to serve. Here at the church, we can serve as worship leaders, like Gary is doing right now. I am a worship leader when I stand, oh, this is from the point of view of the kid mouse. I am a worship leader when I stand on tiptoe to light the candles at the beginning of the service and snuff them out at the end. Everyone watches. I am a worship leader when I shake people's hands at the front door and say good morning. And when I pass offering plates and sing with the junior choir, or raise my hand to share a joy or concern before the pastor's prayer, I wonder if I could ever preach a sermon. That would be hard, it says. Guess what?
It is hard.
And it says, God calls us to serve. So ordinary times is also, some people call it growing times. It's our time to really, really focus on God and growing in faith. And you know what? I just thought of, a lot of you are probably about old enough to start lighting a candle, if you're ready to do it. Maybe with some help. We'll talk to you about that later. Some of you are not right there. Okay, let's stand up and pray and be blessed. Ooh, we got our beloved children,
God's beloved child, with you, God is well pleased.
Because Jesus had ordered the evil spirit to go out of him. Many times it had seized him, and even though he was kept a prisoner, his hands and feet tied with chains, he would break the chains and be driven by the demon into the desert. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "My name is Mog," he had answered, "because many demons had gone into him." The demons begged Jesus not to send them into the abyss. There was a large herd of pigs nearby, feeding on a hillside. So the demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he let them. They went out of the man into the pigs. The whole herd raced down the side of the cliff into the lake and were drowned. The men who had been taking care of the pigs saw what happened. So they ran off and spread the news in the town and among the farms. People went out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were all afraid. Those who had seen it told people how the man had been cured. Then all the people from that territory asked Jesus to go away because they were terribly afraid. So Jesus got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged Jesus, "Let me go with you." But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Go back home and tell God has done for you." The man went through the town telling what Jesus had done for him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our scripture reading this morning from the Old Testament, from the Hebrew scripture, which is Psalm 42. Listen for God's word for you this day. As a deer longs for flowing streams, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and behold the face of God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me continually, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I went with the throng and led them in procession to the house of God, with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God. My soul is cast down within me, therefore I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep at the thunder of your cataracts, all your waves and your billows have gone over me. By day the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night his song is with me. A prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I walk about mournfully because the enemy oppresses me? With a deadly wound in my body, my adversaries taunt me. When they say to me continually, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Holy, holy one, your words feed us. The word frees us, and the Spirit gives us life. Grant our ears an appetite for hearing, and our spirits strength for loving you. And may the words of my mouth
and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer.
Some of you will remember that I used to drive a 2002 Prius with a racing stripe and a number 42 on it. People often asked me the significance of the number 42, and the honest truth is, I do not know. I bought the car used, and it was like that when I got it. I suspect that it comes from the book Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which I've never read, but my understanding is that 42 is somehow the answer.
Yep, it is.
And of course, 42 is also Jackie Robinson's number, which is, for me, more compelling. But even more compelling than that, Psalm 42 happened to be used in chapel at seminary the day that I took possession of the car, so I felt like it was meant to be, and that this psalm has ever since had a special spot in my heart. So our journey through the Bible in a year brings us now to the book of Psalms. Indeed, we'll be in Psalms for the rest of June, and the Psalter, that is, the book of Psalms, was basically the hymnal of ancient Israel, and most of the psalms were likely composed to be sung to music rather than read, and within the worship context as well. And just like our hymnal, the Psalter contains a variety of different types of songs. The hymns include hymns of praise, and Roman hymns, those are hymns celebrating God's kingship. There are psalms of the Psalms of Zion, expressing devotion to Jerusalem. There are the Psalms of Lament, in which the individual seeks deliverance from illness and or from false accusation, or when the nation as a whole seeks deliverance from an enemy or an oppressor. There's the Psalms of Trust, declaring the confidence in God's ability and willingness to come to their aid. There's the Psalms of Thanksgiving, that probably doesn't require any further explanation. And sacred history psalms recount God's history with God's people. Royal psalms were used for coronations and royal weddings. Wisdom psalms are meditations on the nature of God. And finally, liturgy psalms written for special historical or religious events and services, such as the renewal of the covenant. But what's so beautiful about the psalms, what makes them so timeless and relevant all these millennia after they were written, is that from the first psalm through to the Psalm 150, the Psalter pretty well covers the full span of the human condition. Sorrow, joy, suffering, triumph, gratitude, vengeance, love. It's all that and more, and all within the context of our relationship with God. Today's psalm is one of lament, and like most biblical laments, it contains elements of praise and trust as well. This year, the women's Bible study topic was laments, and we learned that contrary to popular belief, laments aren't just about complaining to God. Yes, there is that element of describing the suffering that an individual or the nation are experiencing, but it's not only that. There's also asking God for deliverance and trusting God is able and willing to provide that deliverance. Oftentimes, there's also a recollection of the times that God has come to the aid in the past. Now, today's psalm, Psalm 42, beautifully expands on the contradictory longing for God that's juxtaposed against the sense that God is absent. I believe that we all sense this at some point in our lives, perhaps at many points in our lives. For some of us, perhaps less for others. As St. Augustine wrote, our souls are restless till they find their rest in God. Our souls are restless till they find their rest in God. And when I say all of us, I mean all of us. I truly believe that it is the universal human condition to yearn for God and to feel God's absence. Now, of course, many people don't recognize it as such. Many people would deny it or wouldn't name what they are yearning for as God. But we are all seeking something to make it all make sense, whether or not we name that something as God. And this psalm begins with that yearning. As a deer longs for the flowing streams, so my soul longs for you, O God. The psalmist uses this beautiful imagery of a deer thirsting for the refreshment of a flowing stream as a metaphor for the psalmist's own yearning for God. I've always envisioned the deer lapping up water from a stream in this idyllic forest setting. But it occurs to me that that's not what this verse is about. At least in this verse, the deer is still longing for that stream, not drinking from it. Just as the psalmist still yearns to experience God and has yet to do so, at least not in the way that the psalmist anticipates and desires. The psalmist, it seems, has been prevented by illness from making the pilgrimage to Jerusalem. And the author is outcast from the community, indeed mocked by some who ask, where is your God? The author recalls the times when they were able to join the throng procession to the house of God with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving and celebration of religious festivals. And then we come to this beautiful refrain, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Putting words again to that which I believe we all felt at some time and probably will feel again sometimes as we name the cause of our cast down soul. Sometimes we might not even know. This last year, the pandemic has certainly amplified the cast down, disquieted souls for many of us for so many different reasons. For social isolation, for illness, for fear of illness, loss of so much, loss of loved ones, experiences, rites of passage, employment, income, housing. Of course, there's over 600,000 dead from COVID in the U.S. alone. There's the existential crisis of climate change. There's gun violence. There's racial reckoning. There's terrorism, war, the worst refugee crisis the world has ever known. There's plenty of causes for cast down and disquieted souls. And as a result, there's also been a sharp rise in what's called deaths of despair. Over the course of the pandemic, that is, the deaths by suicide, drug overdose, and alcoholism. Like the psalmist, we as individuals, as a nation, as a world, have plenty of reason for downcast, disquieted souls. But the psalmist follows, "Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me?" The psalmist follows that with hope, with trust in and praise of God, declaring hope in God, "For I shall again praise him, my help and my God." And these two verses are repeated at the end of Psalm 42 and then again at the end of Psalm 43, which is why these two psalms are considered as one, typically, rather than separately. Psalmist says, "Why are you cast down on my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God." After Mother Teresa's death, it became public that she had suffered herself from this sense of estrangement from God. And many scoffed that, oh, this was proof that faith in general Christianity specifically are nonsense. But to me, it's just the opposite. After all, even Jesus on the cross questioned, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Which, of course, comes from another psalm of lament. And like the psalmist, Mother Teresa longed for God. And despite frequently feeling estranged from God, she continued to work the work of her faith. She continued to have hope, and she continued to trust in God. But despite my love of this psalm, I have to admit I have struggled all week with what to say about this psalm. In my study of commentaries, I couldn't help but feel that the academic dissection of the psalm was akin to taking apart and analyzing a joke, rendering the joke no longer funny. And so rather than say anything more, I'm simply going to reread the psalm to you, slowly this time, to give you the opportunity to really take it in and savor it. And I also want to include the five verses from Psalm 43, which, as I mentioned before, are considered to be one with Psalm 42. Afterwards, I'll give a brief time of silence for reflection. Hear God's word for you this day. As a salt deer longs for the flowing streams, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and behold the face of God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me continually, "Where is your God?" These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I went with the throng and led them in procession to the house of God, with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God. My soul is cast down within me. Therefore I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon. from Mount Izar. Deep calls to deep are the thunder of your cataracts. All your waves and your billows have gone over me. By day, the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I walk about mournfully because of the enemy oppressing me? As with a deadly wound in my body, my adversaries taunt me, while they say to me continually, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise you, my help and my God. Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people. And those who are deceitful and unjust, deliver me. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you cast me off? Why must I walk about mournfully because of the oppression of the enemy? Oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God, to the joy of my exceeding, to the God of my exceeding joy. And I will praise you with the harp of God, my God. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise God, my help and my God. Let us, with the psalmist, place our trust in God, place our hope in God, praise God, our help and our God. May it be so.
Though we're not passing offering plates down in the pews at this time, please remember there is one back in the narthex. We are called to give back a portion of what God has provided. Let us take this time to consider our commitments to tithes, offerings, time and talents, to support the ministry of our church family, our community, and beyond. May we give with an open heart to share Christ's reconciliation throughout the world. God gives us more than enough for our journey of faith. Let us reflect on our tithes and offerings, giving generously that others may know their blessings and give thanks to God.
Thank you.
us pray. Triune God, through Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring hope to the despairing, healing to the sick, and release from bondage to all who are oppressed by sin. Through baptism into Christ, you cover us with your blood. We thank you that in that flood you wash away all that separates us from you and one another. We thank you that in this new life we are set free to proclaim good news to others. Direct our gifts to fulfill your purpose as we await the time when all creation is one in your love. By the grace of Jesus Christ and the community of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Your reign with gladness. Grant world leaders wisdom and humility.
ears to attend to the voice of your poets and prophets through whom your spirit speaks. We pray for the most vulnerable, for creatures threatened by with extinction, for those of the human family who are poor, homeless, or refugees, victims of political or domestic violence, for those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. Grant us compassionate hearts, inspired minds, and wills resolved to care for our neighbors with the love of Christ Jesus when we bring your promised kingdom. All your creatures will shout glory, all your people will sigh loud, and all creation will together sing hallelujah. We pray these things in your Son's name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, go out into the world in peace. Go out into the world in peace. Confident, hopeful, trusting in the love of God, who is with us, whether we feel it or not, and especially when we don't. Friends, go out into the world in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ